You all are in for quite a yarn this evening from Joshua Hammer. Josh is a journalist by training and had a pretty adventurous globe-trotting run with Newsweek over the course of nearly two decades. He joined Newsweek in the late 1980s as a business and media writer, but within a few years, he was off to cover the rest of the world on postings that based him in Nairobi, Buenos Aires, Berlin, Jerusalem, Cape Town, and for a few years back here in the U.S. as bureau chief in Los Angeles. For the past 10 years, he's continued to report and travel widely, writing for Smithsonian Magazine, the New York Review of Books, and some other publications. Along the way, he's also written three previous books, one on his younger brother, who became a religious fundamentalist, another on tensions in the town of Bethlehem about a decade and a half ago, and a third on the deadly 1923 earthquake and fire that struck Japan. In his latest book, The Badass Librarians of Timbuktu and Their Race to Save the World's Most Precious Manuscripts, I just love to say badass. I don't get to say that too often. In this latest book, Josh takes us to a country that hasn't really gotten much attention in the press, and that's Mali. Of course, Mali has been battling a radical Islamist movement in recent years, and this is the background for Josh's riveting tale, which is about how an archivist in the northern town of Timbuktu managed with some very brave helpers to smuggle more than 350,000 historical manuscripts out from under militant jihadists to safety about 600 miles away in the southern city of Bamako. The history of how all these manuscripts ended up stored in Timbuktu in the first place is fascinating. And the story of how they were then saved from likely destruction by Al-Qaeda-affiliated militants is quite thrilling. But there's a larger lesson to be drawn from Josh's book, which is that for all the controversy about Islam these days and what it teaches or doesn't teach, about what it inspires or doesn't inspire, there are some very determined and courageous Muslims out there in the midst of the violence and bloodshed, who treasure the intellectualness, the diversity, the richness of their Islamic culture, and are going to great lengths to try to preserve it in the face of the current onslaught by barbaric jihadists. So, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Joshua Hammer.
Thanks very much. This definitely beats the seven people that showed up at Google in San Francisco last week. I'm amazed. I'm really amazed. Right. Anyway, it's a real honor and a pleasure to be at the legendary Politics and Prose bookstore. And yes, I can. Is that better? There we go. I have to do a kind of acrobatic because I want to show pictures so you get those of you who have not been to Mali, which I assume are many of you. Can get a sense of this place because visually it's one of the, I've traveled all over the world and Mali is one of the most striking, I would hesitate to use the word beautiful, I would say, although parts of it are, but striking countries I've visited. So basically what I want to do is a kind of multimedia. I actually had some Malian music in it, but I decided too many things to worry about. So I will talk a little bit from a very personal perspective about this book and also how I found the story and reported the story over the years, because this really does date back almost two decades. In fact, more than two decades. So Timbuktu, my first encounter with Timbuktu was in 1995 when I was Nairobi bureau chief for Newsweek at the time. And in those days, as my former LA Times colleague John Balzar, who was with me on that first trip to Timbuktu, will attest, we foreign correspondents in those days, it was the golden age of journalism, really, of that kind of journalism, when you could pretty much have, as a foreign correspondent, have carte blanche to travel. I was given essentially the, it was a really amazing job. I mean, I land, based in Nairobi, with the freedom to go pretty much anywhere, anywhere, not even pretty much, everywhere in Africa, disappear for 2-3 weeks. If you were a single guy, it was a lot easier, obviously, as I was in those days. So John and I and another colleague ventured off to Mali, and we all had this idea of Timbuktu as a place we had to visit, and if we were going to be in Mali. So we chartered an airplane, which is something you probably could not get away with these days. We chartered a small plane, and we flew to Timbuktu from the capital, Bamako. And correct me if my memories are failing, but we basically had to, we were on a meter, so we couldn't, we could only spend a couple of hours there, or it would have gotten really crazy, like five figures. So we wanted to keep it to a nice four figures, as our, and we parked the plane and somehow got into town, had basically 2 hours to wander around this city, which was at that time in the middle of a Tuareg rebellion. Tuaregs are the local nomads in the Sahara. We raced around this place. It was really desolate. There hadn't had, that tourist just did not come. It was too dangerous at the time. It was isolated. The only way in or out really was by a chartered plane or by riverboat. The river was low, so nobody was getting in, and except guys like us who could spend $10,000 of our employer's money to visit. But I mean, I remember visiting these houses where the 19th century explorers like René Caillie and Gordon Lang, the first European in several hundred years to enter Timbuktu by crossing the Sahara, there was his house, the place he had stayed before he was, he left the city and was murdered days later by his escorts who were supposed to take him safely back to Tripoli. And there was something, it was not a particularly prepossessing town, as these, I have a couple of shots here, sorry, sometimes I get so carried away with my talk that I forget I've actually got pictures. But these are some, this is the Sankore Mosque, the oldest or one of the oldest mosques in Timbuktu, a really unique style that blends a little bit of Egyptian pyramids with the North African mud architecture. These are, hang on, whoops. Okay, so they're typical street limestone houses for the more affluent, mud huts for the less affluent, alleys of sand, really just sand and monochromatic place. Another alley in Timbuktu. I'm getting ahead of myself because I forget how many slides, you know. Anyway, short, so just to wrap that up, that was just an it wasn't a beautiful place. It was a desolate place, but there was something about it that stayed in our minds, in my mind, I'm sure in John's as well, as it just, we made it to Timbuktu. So 10 years later, flash forward, 2006, I left Newsweek. I'd been there for as a foreign correspondent for about 14 years, traveling around the globe. I left, I became a freelance writer, wanted to write long narrative journalism and books, and felt I needed to end my Newsweek career, which I did. And became a freelancer, scrambling around for ideas to get this new career of mine off the ground, came across a clip about these manuscripts, this tradition of manuscripts that had been lost over the centuries that was being rediscovered in Timbuktu, and books were coming out of the woodwork and being preserved, libraries were being built. This was caught my eye, Timbuktu. Caught the eye of my editor at Smithsonian magazine, where I just started a former relationship, and within about a week I was on my way back to Timbuktu, which had changed dramatically by the time I got up there. That war with the Tuaregs was over. Libraries were being built. There were scholars coming in from all over the world. People had cell phones. There were commercial flights running several times a week. It was very easy to catch a commercial flight up there. While I was there, I made the acquaintance of this gentleman. That's why I said I'm getting ahead of myself. But this is Abdel Kader Haidara, who was at the time, really, if you wanted to write about the manuscripts of Timbuktu, this was the man you saw. He was the son of a scholar. He was a manuscript collector. And he was the force behind, really the single force behind the revival of the manuscript tradition in Timbuktu. Let's see, hang on a sec. Whoops, sorry. Abdel Kader, why is that not happening? Whoops, hang on, I'm sorry. Abdel Kader, help. Oh, there we go. Ah, there we go. All right. So Abdel Kader, what was he do? Who was he? What was he doing? As I learned from Abdel Kader, because I really didn't know much about these manuscripts at all. He was my tutor in this whole thing. I spent a couple of days with him while I was up there. As I learned, and as I sort of had vague ideas about Timbuktu, this metaphor for desolation and loss and remoteness had been in the 15th and 16th centuries, both a commercial center, a trading capital. It was where the river met the desert. It was the highest point of the Niger River, and a meeting place for camel caravans that came across the Sahara, carrying goods from as far away as England, to Timbuktu, meeting boats that would come up the Niger River bearing slaves, bearing gold, bearing whatever tropical, you name it, whatever came out of tropical sub-Saharan Africa, it was all this stuff was being traded in Timbuktu. The wealth of the place became extraordinary. At the same time, it grew into a scholastic center under the leadership of two or three very benevolent, open-minded kings. They were Islamic, but they were also quite tolerant and open to ideas from all of these. This place was just a great, you had cross-fertilization in Timbuktu of people from all over the world, really, well, all over the Islamic world, and some from Europe, Arab speakers of 5-10 different languages, all converging on this city. Universities were built, scribes began turning out manuscripts, both copying things from other countries, from Egypt, from Arabia, and also producing manuscripts on their own. This was a place where Islam could be defined as a tolerant, open, multicultural religion, where secularism and religion really lived side by, coexisted well. So you had Qurans, you had Hadith, the sayings of the Prophet. You also had a tremendous proliferation of secular works as well. Just to give you a sense of some of these, there's that thing again. Okay, so this actually is an end paper from my book. This is a Quran, but you can see the incredible care and beauty that some of these works had. They were scribes and artists used gold leaf, they used colors, they used magnificent calligraphy. And as I said, you had the holy books, but you also had works of astronomy, you had works of poetry, you had works about romantic love, you had works about music, you had the translations of the Greek philosophers. There was a sex manual that I discovered about, you know, offering guys, squeeze a lizard penis over a dried lizard penis over an acacia leaf and add it to water and drink it 5 times and say a prayer to Allah and, you know, you're set. So these were some of it was just an incredible variety of stuff, and it all kind of coexisted and proliferated in Timbuktu. What happened over the centuries, so in the 1591 to be precise, Morocco invaded Timbuktu. Scholars were taken into captivity. They were marched out in chains, put on camels, taken into the desert, turned into slaves in places like Casablanca, like Fez, like Marrakesh. The great trade in manuscripts at that point. Sorry, I'm hitting the wrong button. That's what I'm doing. Keep doing that. Okay. Anyway, let's see. So again, I believe this is a book about it's either a diagram about Arabic poetry, or it's a guide to behavior, how to be a proper Muslim. I don't remember which one. I don't read classical Arabic. And that's the problem, by the way, is that 98% of these books have never been translated into any other language. They only exist in Arabic. So nobody really, even today, has a great, clear idea of what most of these works are. We just know from the scholars, a few have been translated, but the vast majority of them, and we'll get to that, have not been translated from Arabic. So by 1600 with the scholars being evacuated at sword point from Timbuktu, the drying up of the standard cross desert trade routes, the city kind of sank into obscurity. Over the next several hundred years, what happened to these manuscripts? Well, families passed them down. The scion of the family would die and bequeath his books to 10 kids. And they would be transported, you know, out of the Timbuktu, maybe into villages in the desert, maybe down to Bamako, out of the country. Over those hundreds of years, you had several cases of bubonic plague breaking out, which destroyed Timbuktu's culture even more. You had a jihadist movement in the 19th century, actually. Malians who had been to Mecca, who were influenced by Wahhabism, which of course was beginning around this period. So an early form of jihadism, which was imported back to Timbuktu. These people were also against the books, so libraries were driven underground. And then the coup de grace, actually, was in about 1880 when the French colonials invaded and conquered Mali, conquered Timbuktu in, I believe, 1894, and then began systematically. They found out about these manuscripts. They were fascinated by them. So they began going sort of on a house-to-house search, looking for whatever remained, grabbing the ones that they liked best, taking them, transporting them, buying them or stealing them more often, and bringing them up to France, where they are still, many of them are on display at La Bibliothèque Nationale and other libraries across France. Let's see, just a couple more, I think, just to give you, yeah, this gives you pretty much these are some of the finer works. Okay, enter Abdel Kader Haidara in the 1980s, when he was the son of a librarian and a budding scholar himself. At around this time, UNESCO had gotten involved in this manuscript. The manuscripts, the whole idea of a written culture in this part of the world, becomes so lost that people like Hugh Trevor Roper were saying things in 1960, the year of Mali had, when it achieved its independence, said something to the effect of, Africa has no history. The only history made in Africa were by the European colonizers. The rest is darkness. This was kind of a playing upon the a continuation of the philosophy of the beliefs propagated by people like Hegel and Kant and Hume in the 18th and early 19th centuries, the Age of Enlightenment, who also spread this idea around that Africans had no written history, they had no culture, anything south of anything sub-Sahara was darkness. Obviously, these manuscripts prove the contrary, but they had really largely been lost. Abdel Kader Haidara, with the support of UNESCO and Middle Eastern governments of Kuwait and Saudi Arabia, oddly enough, took it upon himself as a new employee of the Ahmed Baba Center, a government library in Timbuktu, to go out and find these manuscripts. His father was a librarian, as I said. He was asked by the curator at this new library to become a, as they say in Mali, a prospector for the hidden works. He didn't want to do it at first. He was reluctant. Wanted to make money, he told me. Wanted to become a businessman. Didn't want to spend his life, he imagined, burrowed away in a library. This was not how he envisioned his life. The curator prevailed upon him to do it. So he began, and it turned out that he had an incredible flair for this. So he set out on this mission across some of the most inhospitable terrain on the planet. This, by the way, is a shot I took many years later of this is the road to Timbuktu. If you want to travel by road now to Timbuktu, it's 100 miles of this from a market town called Duenza, where the paved road ends. So this is what Abdel Kader Haidara found himself doing. He would travel, and by the way, he didn't like to use vehicles because he believed that vehicles would be too ostentatious. He wanted to get good bargains from people, so he wanted to be down at their level and show that he was a poor, humble man. So he would often go on foot, or he would go on camel caravans, one-man band, carrying satchel of money given to him by the Saudis and the Kuwaitis, sometimes often thousands of dollars in cash stuffed in his robes. And he would venture out on these weeks-long odysseys across Mali, the north, across this kind of terrain. This is what passes for a lake in northern Mali. This is between the town of Timbuktu and the town of Gao, at the very eastern edge of Mali, the old empire, the capital of the ancient, not so well, 16th century empire, the Malian Empire. This was the kind of terrain that he found himself traveling on. He traveled by road, he traveled by camel, he traveled by riverboat across this very desolate, sometimes desolately beautiful land. Niger River. And he would visit these towns, and he would negotiate and bargain and gradually develop more expertise, kind of figured out what made a great book, what made a valuable book, and became more and more confident. And in the course of, I should also point out that in the Ahmed Baba Institute had been around for a few years, but they had not succeeded in building any kind of collection. So this is why they basically got rid of all the old prospectors and asked Abdel Kader to do it. He proved amazingly successful at it. And in the course of 12 years, am I being heard okay? I just realized I keep, okay. In the course of 12 years, from 1984 to 1996, he amassed something like 30 to 35,000 volumes for the Ahmed Baba Library, which was, you have to realize, in the 10 years before he set out to do this, they had a total of about 1,500 volumes. So he, you know, exponentially increased this collection, and single-handedly, he was he was the only guy doing this. Hang on a sec, whoops. Okay, again, I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's abbreviate the next few years and bring it up to this. 1996, he went out on his own, decided he was getting married, he wanted to settle down, these trips were taking him away 300 days a year. He wanted, you know, like we all do at some point, stability and a more sedentary existence. He decided that what he was going to do was devote his energies now to building his own library. His family over the centuries had amassed an incredible collection. So he set out to build his own library. He succeeded, with the help of Henry Louis Gates, the Harvard professor, in raising funds from the Andrew Mellon Foundation, built a library. With Abdel Kader as the catalyst, this incredible renaissance in Timbuktu took place over the next decade. Other foundations began looking at what was going on there. Abdel Kader created a library association encouraging other Malian collectors to ask the Ford Foundation, hit up the Dutch, hit up the French, hit up anyone they could for money. And the money started pouring into Timbuktu. Libraries were built. More manuscripts were being found in the desert. Families who had dispersed these books across the desert were sort of becoming prospecteurs themselves, and bringing them, you know, uniting all of these books, which had been dispersed through, you know, hundreds of family members. Everything was regathered back in Timbuktu. By 2006, when I made my first trip there after our crazy 95 expedition, when I went there to meet Abdel Kader, there were something like 300,000 manuscripts all recollected in Timbuktu, and something like, you never really know with these numbers that the Malians throw around, but you want to heard that 40 to 50 libraries, but they ranging from, for instance, the new Ahmed Baba Center to replace the one that Abdel Kader had worked in, which was created by Thabo Mbeki, the president of South Africa, who made a trip to Mali and fell in love with the manuscripts, got the South African government to allocate $8 million and created this huge building in the middle, the biggest building in Timbuktu, aside from the Wahhabi Mosque, which was built a year later, which gets to the next part of the story. And Abdel Kader had a beautiful library himself, and, you know, others had these, others were storage rooms, essentially mud huts with a bunch of books in them. But I would say a couple of dozen of them, by my estimation, were, you know, quite nice buildings with climate-controlled rooms and exhibition halls. And, it's, you know, this is the city that was completely desolate and destitute, really transformed in 10 years, thanks to Abdel Kader, into a, I would hesitate to say it was a second golden age of Timbuktu, but compared to where the city had come from, it was a remarkable transformation. The next stage of this story, and the one that I would, that sort of becomes the, is the driving event of my book. is what was actually going on simultaneously with this manuscript revival, which was that in the early 2000s, as Abdel Kader was recreating Timbuktu and showing off its secular religious tradition and this as the center of moderate multicultural tolerance and curiosity, a jihadist movement was growing in the desert. It began, one could probably trace it to the Algerian civil war just across the border in the 1990s, when Islamists fought against the Algerian military government, and you had a huge radicalization taking place across the border. Those people, beginning in about 2003, began to move across the border into Mali, which had a vast, unpatrolled desert, a very poor, weak army. As we know from ISIS, Islamic State, jihadists love a vacuum. And sure enough, eventually, we're not talking about a lot of guys, a couple of thousand jihadists, but they began filling this vacuum, using it as training ground. Malian Western tourists would pass through this desert. Some of them would be grabbed and held hostage. In the figure that I use in my book is between 2003 and 2012, the group, which became known as Al-Qaeda in the Islamic Maghreb, amassed $136 million in ransoms. Because the Europeans were, the general difference between, as we've seen in many other cases, between the James Foley kidnapping and what's been going on in Syria, is that the Europeans pay and the Americans don't. And the Europeans are all too happy to pay. So they were, you know, small groups of European tourists were being ransomed out for $12 million, $14 million, not a lot of negotiation. I understand the, considering that the alternative would have been public executions, it's easy to understand that perspective, but at that strategy. But at the same time, it was no doubt empowering the jihadis, giving them money for weapons, giving them money for recruiting. All this culminated, of course, in the Arab Spring, with the unsettling effects of the Arab Spring. In 2011, you had Tunisia, you had Egypt, you had the fall of Gaddafi in Libya, 1, 2, 3, rapid succession. I believe Gaddafi was killed in July, if I'm not mistaken, 2011. By August, September, Libya was in chaos. There was no government. No preparations had been made for what would happen post-Gaddafi, as we know. The arsenals of this government, which had amassed an incredible amount of weaponry, were thrown open for anyone really to have access to. Jihadists crossed the desert from Mali, filled up their pickup trucks with weapons. Tuareg rebels, the secular Berber tribe in the Sahara that had long wanted its own nation called Azawad that would be carved out of the Sahara. These people, simultaneous with the jihadis, also grabbed the weapons. In late 2011, they formed a kind of uncomfortable, unholy alliance, pooled their weapons, pooled their fighters, and began this conquest of Mali. U.S. forces had been training Malian soldiers, but not doing a very good job of it. And in rapid succession between January and April 2012, two-thirds of Mali was taken over by rebels. They just sent the army fleeing, captured towns. Timbuktu fell on April 1st, 2012. And let me see, I even forget what I have next. Good timing. And instituted Sharia law. One of the first and most sort of heinous acts in the eyes of the Timbuktu residents was the destruction of these Sufi shrines, Sufism being the moderate form, mystical form of Islam that was practiced in Timbuktu and much of North Africa. Shrines were built to Sufi saints. Many of these saints were martyrs, were real people, martyrs who opposed the Moroccan invasion and were slaughtered as a result back in 400 years earlier. But they were revered by the people of Timbuktu for centuries as mystical figures. They had shrines all over the city, 99 of them, I think. the jihadi system out, and they weren't particularly ostentatious or even nice, but they were just holy places where which provided sustenance for the people of Timbuktu. These were destroyed one after another by the jihadis, just with hammers and chisels, pretty low-tech stuff. I mean, but, you know, in a couple of hours, they would swarm these things and destroy them. This is a picture I took about a year later of a graveyard with one of these destroyed shrines. Okay, so, right, jumping a little ahead of myself again. Sorry, I've been working on this coordination for days and never quite getting it. The last part of the book is the story of what happened next, and this I'm going to kind of leave somewhat of a mystery, so to encourage you to buy the book and find out. Otherwise, it wouldn't be a thriller if I gave you all the clue. But let's just say that there was a clear perception, especially after the destruction of these secular Sufi shrines, that the manuscripts would be in danger. The jihadists early on they were aware of them. They made public commentary on television and on radio saying that they respected the manuscripts, that they would not destroy them, but simply the act of acknowledging that these manuscripts existed, that they had their eye on them, scared a lot of people in Timbuktu, especially Abdel Kader, who believed that the situation in Timbuktu was so volatile, with Sharia law being carried out, with amputations. In Libya, the same thing was happening with a Salafist movement that had opened fire on a library with mortars and set it on fire, destroying thousands of manuscripts contained in this library. Abdel Kader was very fearful that the manuscripts were in danger. So he and a small group of his collectors, of fellow librarians and others, decided that the only solution would be to save them somehow. They then put in toward the middle of April, a couple of weeks after the jihadis took over the city, they began a series of clandestine meetings to figure out how they could save the manuscripts. And this followed a series. It was actually a very distinctive three-phase rescue plan. The first phase, and that's as far as I'm going to tell you, involved taking these manuscripts. Well, I'll tell you a little more, but because I have these pictures, so the first doesn't make sense if I just leave you hanging. But okay, so they took these manuscripts and they realized that the libraries were ostentatious, conspicuous places that the jihadis, as they did in Libya, you know, should the moment be right, they decided they wanted vengeance or wanted to hold the manuscripts hostage to prevent being attacked, or just didn't like them because they had, you know, stories about how to reach orgasm by, you know, licking a chameleon penis, whatever. So whatever. These were things that were all worries of Abdel Kader and his group. And so stage one was to get into these libraries in the dead of night with flashlights, because the jihadis had cut all the power in Timbuktu in the night. They also had a curfew. So they had to make these secret raids on their own libraries and move these books in small numbers out from the libraries into safe houses that had been organized in advance. That was just the first step of the operation. Step two, when it became, in their minds, too dangerous even to keep these manuscripts in Timbuktu, because things were really getting nasty then with public amputations and public executions and stonings and just craziness. Step two was just, hey, they're not safe in Timbuktu any longer. We got to get them out of the city to government territory where they will be safer. So that really occupied the vast, you know, the next several months, was this incredibly elaborate procedure that these are kind of pictures to give you an idea of the terrain. A typical boat on the Niger River that was used as a transport vessel. Again, Niger River. This whole process ended basically when, and the final spasm of this whole story ends with a French invasion in January 2013, after the jihadists had been in power for 8 months. Of course, as jihadists are wont to do, they overreached. They decided, well, we've been captured two-thirds of the country. That's not enough. We want the whole country. We want to declare Mali a Sharia state, a caliphate. So they got all their pickup trucks together and they made this move and they ventured down, you know, it's 660 miles to Bamako, the capital. That was their next quest. They were going to seize the capital and basically declare the entire country under jihadist control. Overreaching. This got the French involved. Hollande ordered an invasion by a small French force, got up to about 2,500 men, began this period of intense bombings of jihadist positions, missile attacks, ground forces, the kind of thing that, you know, only the French have been willing to pull off, at least since the Iraq War. I mean, a real literal ground invasion plus air invasion of jihadi territory. So this, of course, meanwhile, you have to imagine that this lift, this smuggling operation was going on even as these planes and helicopters were flying overhead, flying missiles at anything that moved. So this is kind of the last section of the book, which unfolds in the course of this very short but very deadly war. Let's see. And these are just shots that I took probably, I think this was in, the war was over by March 2013. I made my first return trip to, I'm sorry, I was there in January 2013 with the French. And then I made a return trip in August 2013, the first of a couple more, where I was able to actually get up to Timbuktu and see the remains of the jihadists. And, you know, this was an ammo truck, I believe, that was attacked by French missiles. In a final spasm of violence in August, in January 2013, as the French were about to invade Timbuktu, 4,000 manuscripts that Abdel Kader had not been able to save were rounded up by the jihadists. These are 14th, 15th century volumes about math and science, astronomy, and put in a big pyre and doused with gasoline and set on fire and destroyed. So for Abdel Kader, this was vindication, you know, that, well, who knows what would have happened if we had not done this. Because there had been some debate whether this huge effort was really, really worth it. In fact, the New York Times book review next Sunday, my reviewer asks whether or not this was really necessary, to which Abdel Kader, and I, to a certain extent, would argue that, you know, there's the result, right? So I think the pictures speak for themselves. This is what was left of the Ahmed Baba Institute when the jihadis destroyed everything they could find before fleeing hours ahead of the French invasion. Final image, and this is where we are today. This is a picture I took either in August 2013 or when I returned in January 2014. But the situation is pretty much the same. You've got these UN peacekeepers, African forces for the most part, along with a vestige of French special forces there, maybe a couple of hundred, that are pretty much holding the north, preventing the jihadists from recapturing the north. And this is a shot that's taken this is the way to cross the Niger River to get to Timbuktu. So I was getting on this ferry as the Burkina Faso Brigade here was disembarking and heading home for R&R. But I just thought it would be useful to show you the sort of the thin blue line right now that is holding the north and preventing this thing from happening all over again. Of course, you know, you've had in the last couple of months terrorist attacks in Bamako, in Burkina Faso, in the Cote d'Ivoire, the same guys, in fact, who managed to escape from the French, including one of the main characters in my book, a one-eyed jihadist named Mokhtar Belmokhtar, who some of you who follow jihadi politics may have even heard of, an Algerian, a really tough, badass jihadist, is kind of, you know, he's still out there in the desert, still carrying out, and in the cities, carrying terrorist attacks. So the story is not over. I think I probably talked longer than I thought, so rather than do a reading, I think it's time to turn things over to you and ask you and please, questions, please go up to the microphone. There's one there and one on the other side. If you have questions, if I can elaborate, shed any more light on this yarn, I'd be happy to. So thanks. So I, I open this to the floor. Does anybody have anything they want to ask? Yes. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Do these libraries have catalogs? Has anybody made an effort to identify what these books are and prioritize translating?
Good question. One of the problems when Abdel Kader Haidara set out in the 1990s to create a library, his own library, after doing the trekking around the desert for 12 years, he applied to all these foundations, and the first thing they said to him was, you know, you want money from us, give us a list, let us know what's in your collection. He said, I don't know. He had never made any effort, nor had any of the previous owners, this father or grandfather, to catalog it. They just had a big piles of these manuscripts in chests, and they didn't have the slightest idea of, I mean, they had a few, Abdel Kader had a few ideas, because people would, his father ran a madrasa, an Islamic school, and would bring some of these manuscripts out and show the kids, and they would sit around reading from whatever astronomy book, law book. So he had a very, very superficial idea of what was there. That's pretty much along the line. The only Henry Louis Gates before the before money was given to create this Mama Haidara Library demanded, one of the demands was that they catalog and digitize. Abdel Kader took the money and ignored them and went ahead and built the library, never bothered. So it was not important to him to do this, nor was it really important. The only, what began at the Ahmed Baba Center, the government library, did have, thanks to Thabo Mbeki's government, thanks to the South Africans, the Norwegians, foreign donors were very insistent that, and this was kind of the showpiece library of Timbuktu. So they demanded digitization and cataloging, but these private collections were largely neglected. Only now, when during this vast smuggling operation, when they were throwing books into chests and mixing and matching, a little bit of this library, just in their haste to get this stuff out of the city, away from the jihadists, Abdel Kader and his colleagues would sort of scribble down on notebook paper who had what. So that was a forced systematic cataloging of all of these volumes. But I think it may have been transferred now to laptops, but, you know, it's still a work in progress, and nobody really has any idea about the, just as none of these works have really been translated. Nobody has any great idea of what actually is there. We have a general idea, and you can point to certain books, but the vast majority of these remain a mystery. Yep. Anyway.
Josh, hi.
Hey, Pat.
What about repercussions? What's happened to Abdel Kader, and what about just general repercussions if there are still jihadists in Mali? And in the region, has there been any, backlash, if you will? How safe are these people who did this?
Yeah, in November 2015, the jihadists carried out an attack on the Radisson Hotel in Bamako, and a foreigners hangout, killed a bunch of aid workers and diplomats. They attacked another Western frequented hotel in Ouagadougou, the capital of Burkina Faso, next door. They carried out this attack on the beach in Cote d'Ivoire. So there are small cells of jihadis running around, I guess integrating into the city, cells that operate probably in urban areas. And there's some in the desert, but they're not able to, because the French killed a whole bunch of them, they don't have the manpower really to occupy, seize territory like the Islamic State can. Although certainly you could argue that their initial action in 2012 was a model for the Islamic State. The idea of, hey, you know, what a great idea. Let's actually declare, seize. I mean, this had never really been done before. The Taliban, I guess, did it in the 90s. But the Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula did it in Yemen. They carved out small areas that they then declared a caliphate in this very weak Yemeni regime, was unable to resist. But nobody had ever done it like the Malian jihadists, where they actually grabbed an area the size of France and declared it a caliphate, and implemented, they created a real government. And so that was emulated, I think, by Islamic State to a great extent. 2 years later, you saw the same thing happen. Probably some of those same guys you know, are now sitting in Mosul. But whether, I don't think it's, they'll be capable of conquering territory in Mali. There's too much, people are watching it too closely. The French are still there. They don't want to see this whole thing backslide to the way it was. And, but the, it's insecure enough so that Abdel Kader is not moving those manuscripts back from there, from safekeeping in the south to Timbuktu. And I don't know when that is going to happen. You asked about repercussions for him.
Yeah, for him and the people who took part in this smuggling.
You know, they're still, they're somewhat discreet about talking. It wasn't that easy even for me to get a lot of information out of them about this whole thing. I had to go back repeatedly and encourage. He was a lot more, he was incredibly vociferous and talking about his, you know, his earlier life, about collecting these manuscripts. But when, he loved talking about that stuff, you know, endless anecdotes. But when it came to, so how did this whole thing proceed? Evasive, vague, it was very frustrating. But, you know, but eventually enough detail came out to pull together a book, barely.
Thanks, Josh.
Yeah, anyone else?
Yeah, what's frustrating about the manuscripts is it's both a fascinating story, but they're just, it's hard to find out what is actually in those manuscripts except for kind of the cursory summary of the various topics that's in them. And I am curious about what exactly is known that would have implications on Islamic jurisprudence. I've recalled in memory, in 1999, there was an Atlantic piece about Quranic texts that were discovered in Yemen.
Uh-huh.
And those texts actually suggested interpretations of the Quran, which is a very radical idea for Muslims, right? Because the Quran is directly spoken. It's supposed to be directly. But it has implications for modernization of Islam and all that. Do these texts have any implications for that?
I think, well, Abdel Kader, who has read a lot of them, though, even there, he even admits that the vast majority of them he hasn't read. There's just too many of them. But he insists that the Islam as portrayed in these, in the works of fiqh, in his, you know, Islamic jurisprudence, in some of these fatwas that were given out and all recorded, and that many of these exist. He insists that they do portray an Islam that is very different from the Wahhabist fundamentalist Islam of the Arabian Peninsula, which was a foreign import and really didn't belong in Timbuktu. I mean, there is a lot of, there are books about conflict resolution and books about slavery and the, you know, the harmful effects of slavery on both the owners and the owned. So, and there are letters, one of his prides, the prides of his collection, in fact, well, it doesn't come from the Golden Age, but it comes from a period when Heinrich Barth, any Timbuktu scholars here might know the name Heinrich Barth. He was a German who trekked across the desert and was like the third explorer to enter Timbuktu. He was taken under the protection of a local figure who protected him. There was at that time a jihadist ruler of the whole area who wanted to kill Barth because Barth was a non-Muslim and he believed that non-Muslims who did not have, you know, shouldn't be barred from the kingdom, and if they're caught, they should be killed. Well, this guy took him under his wing and wrote very eloquent letters, which have actually been translated, arguing that it's the responsibility of Islam to, you know, protect and to be hospitable and to protect all who enter the kingdom, whether he be a Muslim or a non-Muslim, open to all. This is our duty. And so Abdel Kader holds this manuscript. This is one of the sort of the key documents in his collection. He was on display at the Mamahara Library as the true spirit of Islam. You could also argue that, well, maybe this jihadist guy who wanted to kill Barth was actually the, you know, the truth. I don't, you know, it's a constant war in Timbuktu between visions, versions of Islam, and that conflict there is kind of shows what the tensions that have gone on, you know, for an eternity, well, for 500 years in the city. There was also a great amount of, in spite of all this secularism and openness, there was a great animosity towards Jews in the 16th century. The emperor wanted the king of the Malian Empire at one point banned all Jews from the kingdom, exiled them all, arrested some, threatened others with death, and said that any trader who does business with a Jew is going to get kicked out of the kingdom himself. So he eventually had to be, he moderated those views. But as I point out in the book, this kind of tension between forms of Islam has been going on in that corner of the world for a long time, and it kind of reached its apogee in 2011, 2012, but it's not a new phenomenon. Anyone else?
Quickly.
Yes. Oh,
hi.
Sure.
So you may or may not have heard of the Fi Rist, which is in 1000 AD, when Baghdad was the caliphate, this amazing bibliography was created of all books. You've already answered my question in some part since I got up. I'm a former Middle East journalist, uh-huh. and I always love this notion of a bibliography. It sounds like that didn't exist.
Yeah.
Too bad. Or if it did,
maybe it's
lost.
There. Maybe it's in a pile.
Could be.
Somebody's bottom of somebody's trunk.
I was curious, Josh, with this, both the history of conflict, but also this amazing legacy of writing, if there's any remnant or vestigial culture of writers today, what the writing landscape is like today.
Yeah, in Timbuktu.
Well, in Mali generally, but I imagine
I wouldn't say the writing. Well, there are some really well-known writers in Mali who've kind of emerged as voices of, I don't know about fiction.
But are they even interested in these books?
Only in the most sort of vague part of our national patrimony. We have to protect them and celebrate them. But Mali is a very rich, it's a very impoverished country. It's one of the poorest countries in the world, but it's also rich in culture. I didn't even begin to get into one of the subplots of this book, which is about the music of Mali, which happened to flourish.
For the movie.
It flourished side by side with this manuscript revival. You had this festival in the desert in 2000, which began in 2001, and by the time I went there in 2008, and there were like thousands of Westerners and Tinara Wayne, this wonderful, wonderful Tuareg band that's achieved worldwide success, was playing, and I think Tom Freston of MTV and Jimmy Buffett showed up that year to write a piece about it for Vanity Fair.
Well, it's an amazing.
And so this was all going on. Of course, that's all destroyed. Mm. That festival fell to pieces, and as the jihadists took over, made life so dangerous that no foreigners wanted to go near the place, except for Bono. He showed up.
Well, congratulations.
He was the last
it's
one. Thank you. Anyone else? Yeah.
I'd love to find out about badass librarians.
Yeah. Okay.
And
let me ask a quick question. Very controversial. Definitely attracts attention. Not my idea for a title, but I embraced it ultimately. But New York Times and the Washington Post, both in their reviews, said irritating, unnecessary. So I was curious, by a show of hands, who likes that title? Who doesn't like that title? So it's sort of an even, I think the likes win.
Well, okay. there's very radical, maybe not radical, teachers group called Badass Teachers that is fomenting a lot of happenings in the U.S. So. Perhaps.
Also, there's badass librarian. I Googled badass librarians. The badass librarians existed long before this book.
Yeah. So I was curious if there are many women badass librarians in this movement, because gender parity is sort of lacking.
Yeah, you're right.
And I also was wondering, sort of coming back to the question you just referenced, which is in terms of national pride, how much your local secondary school student would know how to spell Timbuktu, would really have a sense of pride.
In Mali, you're talking about secondary students. On the issue of women, I think that Abdel Kader was not, because women were so suppressed by and oppressed by the jihadis, he certainly was not willing to put women's lives on the line. But the fact, women did play a role in that they turned their houses over. They made some of Abdel Kader's cousins and others opened up their homes, turned them into safe houses. And you can keep your books in our storage room. And but it was a men's job for the most part. They were the boat captains and the drivers and the guides and the smugglers, lifting the heavy boxes into Yeah, driving the mule carts that took the manuscripts to the safe houses. This was definitely a male-dominated yeah. business. And your other question was about the average teenage secondary school student.
Young person, what their impression of Timbuktu.
Well, I think the school, there are a lot of kids who don't go to school.
That's right.
And especially in the north, which is the mm-hmm. most impoverished area of the country. But you mean whether they know about this sort of glorious history
yes.
Of Timbuktu? And I don't know. I don't know the answer to that question. Certainly the educated Malians know.
Yes, right.
But a lot of, we're talking about a country with like 50% illiteracy, so, right. or if not more.
Thank you.
Yeah. Anyone else? I guess we're done. It's going once. Yes. Okay. Would you like to get up and... Yeah. Could you let her out?
Well, so I don't know that I have a question, but I traveled in September.
Can you possibly stand up and speak into the microphone? Because this is being YouTubed, so. Yeah.
Well, I was there in the mid-1970s.
Yeah.
And I was young and kind of foolish. I took the boat ride, up the Niger from Bamako.
Uh-huh.
And
a week, right?
It was a long trip.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
At that time, there was so much activity and warm friendliness. And as a woman, I felt like the Tuaregs and everybody else was kind of looking out for me and making sure that I stayed where I'd be safe on this big riverboat and things.
Uh-huh.
But as you were talking, I just sort of wondered what happened to all the life along the river, because it was just unbelievably alive and dynamic at that time.
Yeah, a lot of those river towns, like you probably stopped in Mopti, which became, which is sort of halfway between Bamako and Timbuktu, and John and I were there, and it was a tourist mecca. I mean, it was just a backpackers, mm-hmm. and tourist place where you would take boats out on the river. And there was the Bar Bozo, where your famous place on the Let's Go Africa. What was the name of the Africa on Mali on a shoestring? Lonely Planet, the Lonely Planet guy.
Right, yeah.
Bar Bozo was, anyway, that was a place where you went. All gone. I mean, now just like there are no Westerners anymore. No tourists go. So that was a huge part of the Malian the economy along the river was fed by all these pinas, these motorboat trips up the river. There's still commerce along that river, I mean, for sure, but that money that was fed into the system, millions of dollars a year, mm-hmm. is in a country that doesn't have much at all, has vanished. I mean, almost nobody would travel up even to Mopti anymore. So the vitality has been drained out of that city. I have a close friend she's an American who works there as a travel, she was a tour operator in Bamako, and she had a really thriving business for many years. And beginning in 2011, when there were some kidnappings and murders of Westerners, that business has ended. The only way she survived is by having the foresight to expand to like Ghana and Guinea and other countries. But Mali is, maybe she gets two crazy tourists a year who are willing to just go up to Timbuktu for, despite all the warnings not to. Yeah, and me.
Another thought, there are a lot of, in North Africa, there are universities where there are a lot of students who are multilingual, who know classical Arabic, but it looks like there would be some way of making connections so that all of that North African, the educated talent in North Africa could be put to work on the manuscripts in some way.
Yeah, that work has generated some jobs in Timbuktu. There were a lot. There were, at the height of this boom, hundreds of people who were employed and who were actually sent to South Africa to learn manuscript preservation, and they had these courses, and so it was kind of a booming business actually, but all gone, all gone. Mm. Yeah. Anyone else? Yeah, we have another. Yeah. Okay, last question.
So where are the manuscripts now? You said that they did get taken to Bamako, and I lived in Mali for years, and was back a couple of times in 2013 and 2014, and I think I remember passing a national library, but maybe it wasn't in Bamako. Maybe it was another country.
There's a national library there.
Where
archive,
are they
but
now?
But they're not there. They're being held in these a bunch of storage facilities that were located and sort of converted into storage facilities, like large rooms. About a dozen of them or so. Abdel Kader found them, got money. It was a step-by-step process. First, they were just put in people's basements or back rooms, and the climate in Bamako is very different from Timbuktu. It's a lot of rain, so it wasn't good for the manuscripts. But so then he realized a couple months in that he had to do something, or they were all going to rot. So then they got money from the usual donors, the Dutch, the Germans. I mean, people just came up with some cash, and they created these dozen or so facilities with climate control, dehumidifiers, and they've just been sitting there. They've been sitting there for now 3 years. Waiting, Abdel Kader wants to take a big, do a boat lift in reverse and bring them up river to Timbuktu at some point, but who knows when. So that's it. So thank you very much, and I guess I'll be collecting my royalties here. If you want to